you too.
So we did put
wine.
Better not be listening.
Why?
Better not be.
Did he turn water into wine?
That's all right. They can look at that.
How come they're not?
I know you're kidding.
Isn't there like a new kind of
wine?
I'm just
sparkling water. It's called grapefruit. I don't know. I tell you what, sometimes, not very often, I'll do an order from the airport. Because I don't believe there's anything wrong with it. I mean, first off, that's 28 years I can handle it. But I wouldn't take 3 or 4 or 5. Now I'm asked for trouble.
All right. Good morning. Well, ground this morning. So Kathy's traveling. Brian and Jennifer, I'm not sure about that. They were going to come, but I know he was doing a live service this morning out at the Speedway with the Raceway members. So I think, because I saw that on his Facebook this morning. Oh, she's got the dress on.
Yep.
Let's see, announcements that we have going on. It's not this week that Heaven Saints was going to be here. It's next week. I happen to look, and it's the 17th, not the 10th. So they'll be here next Sunday as well to kind of talk about what they're doing during bike week, and we'll start trying to make some plans also and trying to figure out. Is David going to be down on bike week?
Yeah.
He is. Okay. So we can start trying to figure out what we're going to do again this year. Other announcements, things that folks have. Where's Tank?
We left her at the house.
Oh, okay.
We're going to go back for everything.
We're going to leave her here for a couple weeks.
Okay.
We can leave this one, too.
Yeah, I'll take
it. No, we're not leaving her. Sorry.
We already talked to her about that.
Other things that we need to talk about, announcements, things that are going on. We know there was a ride scheduled this morning for all riders. I don't know if they actually had it or not. I haven't heard. Jeff was going to post something this morning, but I haven't seen that, so we'll find out later today. They may reschedule that one. I don't know. Did the Main Street ride go yesterday?
No, he said he canceled it due to the weather. They were going somewhere else.
Okay.
I didn't go because I had something to do.
Yeah, we were going to go, and then I decided to stay off the bike, so...
Yeah, they canceled the one, the fish slips one. They were doing something small.
Okay.
But Randy was going to borrow a party.
Bobby and Ed are down in the Keys right now. They'll be back this week, so we can keep them in prayer when they travel back. Trying to think if there's anybody else that... The Pageants are gone.
Yep, they're back in Kentucky.
They're back in Kentucky. Okay. Wow, did they go straight back? Because I thought they were going
to go. They went to the Gulf Coast for a couple of days. And then
and they went home. Okay.
So,
all right. Any prayer requests? All right, well, let's open with prayer. And we get started. Lord, thank you for your love and your grace.
Excuse me. Who is the dogs in this church?
I know, everywhere but here.
He was praying with you.
He was praying with me. I know. Thank you for your love and your grace and all that you do and the things that you've done for us this week. I just ask, Lord, a blessing upon those that we know that are traveling. Keep them safe and in your arms throughout the rest of their travels and bring them back here safely. Bless each of us throughout this morning. Allow us to kind of understand your will in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay. He was praying with you.
It was.
What's that?
The snort was the dog, not us.
Are we sure about that?
It was the dog.
Okay, just checking.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, save it, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day and dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. But we've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain,
David, and tell him that you know where it is.
No followers.
David texted this morning to Tanya and said, do we know where our Bibles are?
Oh.
I said, yeah, we all know.
He's in a truck. Somebody took off with it.
Somebody took off with it? Well, he almost rolled his truck this week, so.
Really?
Oh, no.
No, it was a bad road and bad choice.
Yeah, he made a bad choice.
I've been three rollovers.
Well, this morning we're going to be in Numbers, the 16th chapter. We're going to go in the Old Testament this morning. And I want to kind of, before we read this passage, I want to kind of give you some, a picture of what it's about. There was a group of men that followed a gentleman by the name of Korah during the Old Testament days. And Korah was a member of the priest tribe in Israel. What happened was is Korah and several men decided that they were going to kind of throw Aaron and Moses out of power. And so they went in and it's called Korah's Rebellion.
What happened was is that as they began to rebel, God came down and actually just killed Korah and his group of men who were going to rebel against Aaron and Moses. Shortly after that, the people of Israel kind of rose up against Aaron and Moses and began to go toward them in a pretty hostile way. And God had made a decision that he was not done using Moses and Aaron. And so this passage that we're going to read this morning is really a description of what happened during that rebellion. And so, and we'll kind of dig into it a little bit more, but I want you to kind of, if you're with me, Numbers, the 16th chapter, we're going to start in verse 41 and go to 48. Now we're going to jump to Jude and read a couple passages there. But let's start with the 41st verse of the 16th chapter. But on the next day, all the congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and against Aaron, saying, "You have killed the people of the Lord." And when the congregation had assembled against Moses and against Aaron, they turned toward the tent of meeting. And behold, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord appeared. And Moses and Aaron came to the front of the tent of meeting. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Get away from the midst of this congregation, that I may consume them in a moment." And they fell on their faces. And Moses said to Aaron, "Take your censer and put fire on it from off the altar and lay incense on it. Carry it quickly to the congregation and make atonement for them. For wrath has gone out from the Lord and the plague has begun." So Aaron took it as Moses said and ran into the midst of the assembly. And behold, the plague had already begun among the people. And he put on the incense and made atonement for the people. And he stood between the dead and the living, and the plague was stopped. Jumping to Jude, verse 4. Jude is one of those most obscure books in the scriptures. There's a single chapter, so we're going to read verse 4 and verse 11. "For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our Lord into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ." And then in verse 11 it says, "Woe to them, for they walked in the way of the Cain, and abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's error, and perished in Korah's rebellion." Let's bow for a word of prayer, and then we're going to kind of dig in a little bit. Lord, thank you for your love and your grace and for this mercy that you give us. Let us understand your word as we go through this morning and get a better picture of how you want us to live our lives in conjunction with your will. Thank you for allowing us all to be here. Thank you for the folks that we have that are watching, and for the folks that are traveling. Keep them safe. And allow them to also learn your word this morning. Let nothing in us and in our own hearts interfere with your desires in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. I want you to picture this scene in your head. Moses and Aaron come out in front of the tent. There is a group and a crowd coming at them. And God has come down and put himself between Moses and Aaron and decided that there was going to be a plague. And if you think about it, just think about some of the shows you've watched on TV that you could see as this plague began to go back through this crowd, people began to drop dead in front of them. And Moses looks at Aaron and says, "Take your censer, your incense, and make restitution for those people." And Aaron goes into the tent, gets his censer, which is a big ball, puts incense in it, and begins to run into this crowd of people that are dropping dead. And he gets out partway into that crowd, and he prays, and he says, "God, please save these people. Even though they were going to come and kill us, save them from your wrath." And the plague stops. That's a pretty profound picture. When you look at this, you got to understand that Aaron had made this decision to do something that is unnatural to all of us. Anybody seen those zombie movies? Like Night of the Living Dead? And you see all these zombies coming at you? Picture that's what happened, is that Aaron ran into this crowd of zombies and began to pray for them. Even though they were going to kill him, he ran in to pray for forgiveness for them. How many of you ever heard of clinker bricks? Have you ever heard of a clinker brick? Let me give you a picture of what a clinker brick is. A clinker brick is a brick that is usually fired too hot in the kiln. And it gets distorted and it gets brittle. And it gets very difficult to use because it's not a uniform shape. When they come out of the kiln, they're usually a little darker in spots. They don't look good. They're ugly. And in New York, up in upstate New York, there's a little church that, as it was building its church, decided that they were going to save money by using clinker bricks to build their church. And so they did. They built an entire church of clinker bricks. And they did that for two reasons. One is because it was cheaper, but also because it really represented to them what a church is about. It's a bunch of people that are misshapen and deformed and broken that come together to build something to glorify God. So when you look at the concept of a clinker brick, we're all a bunch of clinkers. We're all broken in our own way. We're all stained in our own patterns. There are things about us that are different than others. But when we come together as a group and as a church and as a following of Christ, we can create something that is beautiful, just like that church. And so this morning when we dig into this, I want us to understand that this concept of the church and standing between the living and the dead is what I want us to kind of come to grips with. I want us to understand, are we willing to look at this world in its own brokenness and look at it as it comes apart and stand praying that God will have mercy on us? That's a very profound picture for all of us. You know, we're going into Bike Week. There's a lot of broken, misshapen people at Bike Week. And are we willing to go into that group of people and into that crowd and stand between them and God and say, God, have mercy on those people? Ronald Reagan said this, when we fail to be one nation under God, we will be one nation gone under. We can stand and we can condemn and we can look at those people and say, there's something seriously broken in them. Or we can stand like Aaron and Moses and try to pray that God create a life for them outside of who they are. We can't save everybody. We can't get everybody to come to Christ. But we are called by God to be priests like Aaron and bring people to him. So this morning, I'm going to ask you several questions. I'm going to talk to you about what are we committed to doing. And the first thing we want to look at is, are we committed to go where God calls us to go? Verse 46 says, take your censer, put fire on it from off the altar, and lay incense on it, and carry it quickly to the congregation. Are we willing to do what Aaron did, which is looking at this world that is broken and problematic and struggling, and go where God calls us to be? Or do we stand back and say, not my problem. Those people were mean to me. They're trying to hurt me. I'm not doing anything for them. Or are we willing to go to those places that we know God is needed and reach out to those folks? A few years ago, a man began feeding a bunch of birds in his backyard. And when he began feeding them, he saw that they were very aggressive with each other. They would steal food from each other. They would peck at each other. They would drive off smaller birds. because they weren't sure where the next food was coming from. And the starlings, which are especially mean, would attack other birds because they wanted the food themselves. After years of regular feeding, what he noticed was this: the birds settled down because they always knew where the food was coming from the next time. And so they would quit pecking at each other and fighting with each other, and when he'd show up to put food out, they all would take their turn to get the food. We've seen that with dogs that are food hoarders. When they realize that food is regular, they become less aggressive about getting food. If we want to reach a people that are struggling, if we want to do what God calls us to do, we will find that they will be more receptive of who we are, because they know the next meal. Psalms 126 says, "Brothers and sisters, this is God's law of the harvest. Don't expect to rejoice later on unless you've been willing to sow in tears." And I want to ask you simply this: how much would it cost you to sow in tears? I don't mean just giving money and writing a check. I'm talking about giving of who you are and what is in your heart and soul to help those people that need us in this world. I'm not asking, will you give a little bit? I'm asking, will you give till it hurts? Would I do something unreasonable like Aaron and run into the fray because God calls me to be there? Matthew 28:19 simply says this: "Therefore go into the world and preach the gospel." He doesn't say do it at your convenience. He doesn't say make it easy. He says, when you see the need, are you willing to step between you and those that are about to die? Secondly, we must be open to the direction that the Holy Spirit chooses for us. We need to be doers and not watchers. Verse 47 says, "So Aaron took it as Moses said, and ran into the midst of the assembly." After a preacher died and went to heaven, he got before St. Peter and said, "I don't understand it. I have preached thousands of sermons, and yet this cab driver over here has brought more people to you than me." And Peter said, "It's simply this. When they got into his cab, they were praying that God would save their soul." Our policy isn't about rewarding just the results, it's about rewarding the effort. St. Peter looked at the reverend and simply said, "Whenever you gave a sermon, people were sleeping. When people were in that cab, they were wide awake." James 1:22 says, "Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves." Too many times we hear with our ears, think with our head, and don't follow our heart. We need to look on others with a sense of compassion and love, knowing that we are sometimes in the same place they are. Sometimes we're on the congregation side that's about to die from the plague, and sometimes we're on Moses and Aaron's side trying to bring people to understand God. How many of us have said, "Well, they get what they deserve"? times have all of us said that? Well, they get what they deserve. You know what? Thank God we don't get what we deserve. Because we certainly couldn't get to heaven if we deserved it. You know, Jesus didn't spend his time with his friends and family in church. He spent time with prostitutes and deceivers and liars and tax collectors and all kinds of people of ill will. You know, 2 men were out rabbit hunting. And between them, they probably missed 20 rabbits. And the one looked at the other and said, you know what? Let's miss 5 more and then go on home. When Emily was little, we went squirrel hunting with a friend of ours, Tom. And Tom was an incredible shot with a pistol. He could hit with a 357, he could hit at 25 yards a shotgun shell. But with a rifle, he was terrible. So Emily and I are sitting up on the bank looking for squirrels, and Tom says, well, I'm going to walk down the hill. So he goes down the hill, and we hear bang, bang. Bang, 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 bang. And he comes back up, and I said, well, did you get it? He said, no, that squirrel was like Superman. I hit it like 8 times, and it still kept running. I said, you never hit that squirrel. But he was trying. God's not asking us for the results. He's asking us to try. He will take care of the results. He will take care of the harvest. We just got to put the effort into what he asks us to do. If we shoot enough and we do enough, God will get the results. Thirdly, we got to commit to following God's direction at his appointments, not ours. Just like Aaron, we got to recognize simply this. Our role is not to save the people. Our role is to pray for the people. This country has lost its way. If you read this past week of the things that are related to late-term abortion in Virginia, when you can hear a governor say something as cold as, well, when the baby's born, if it's still alive, we'll keep it comfortable while the mom and the doctor decide what to do. There is something broken in this world. I try not to get real political in sermons, but there is something broken in that statement. We need to understand that the stakes are high in this process. That if we don't go out and do what God calls us to do, no one else will either. Aaron chose to run into the fray. Colin Ray has a song that says, it's called Only Jesus. And his line is simply this. He stumbled in the quick stop, scared us all to death. We smelled the liquor, and I felt on his breath. And I felt the anger rising till I suddenly realized I might be the only Jesus he will ever see. You know, if you're moving the piano, there's 3 kinds of people. There's the person that's pulling the piano, there's the person pushing the piano, and there's the person that picks up the piano stool. And we got to ask ourselves, which one are we? My grandfather was an old railroad guy, and he used to say there's 2 kinds of people. Those who do the work, and those who take the credit for the work. He said, try to be in the first group. If we want to reach out to this world that is broken, if we want to do something beyond allowing it to continue to go the way it's going, then we got to do something to change it. We got to commit to the fray. we also have to have courage to do those things. John 16:33 says, I have said these things to you that in me you have may, you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Aaron had to, within his own heart and soul, gather some strength. Can you imagine looking at a group of people that are dropping dead and you running into them? You know, we hear about these shootings in schools, and there are two kinds of people. There are those that are running away from the shooter, and there are those running toward the shooter. Thank God for those people running toward the shooter. Verses 47 and 48 says, so Aaron took as Moses said, ran into the midst of the assembly, and behold, the plague had already begun. And he put on the incense and made atonement for the people. And he stood between the living and the dead, and the plague was stopped. This world will change when we are willing to stand in firm belief that it can. We need to quit worrying about what's politically correct. We need to quit worrying about saying those things that are offensive. We need to quit saying those things that we think people want to hear. And say those things that God says are important. Now, it's a struggle. We've been going through the statement of faith, and there are things that are very clear in our statement of faith. Not everybody's going to like. But you can't change what the scripture says. We got to quit sitting on the sidelines and get into the battle. You know, back in Civil War days, they would have these battles, and people from the towns would come out, stand around, and watch the battle. It's like a spectator sport. There's even a story about a woman that ended up pregnant from a bullet that went through a man and into her. And whether that's true, nobody knows. But you can't stand on the side of a battle and watch it and expect a different result than what occurs in front of you. We can watch football. We just watched Super Bowl last week. You got to quit standing and watching and get into it. Sitting on the sideline is just not an option in this world anymore. It won't let us do it. We've talked about a lot of things culturally. We've talked about suicide. We've talked about depression. We've talked about conflicts. We've talked about issues. You know what? It's time for us to quit talking about it and do something different. And start impacting people's lives in a positive way. And lastly, we got to get God's strength to stand in the valley. You know, kids were little, I used to tell them I used to walk uphill both ways to school in the snow with no feet.
No feet? That's what your feet
came from. I was telling my brother got the feet. Yep. And I only got it on certain days of the year. But you know what? If we're going to impact God's world and this world and this United States and this country, we got to be willing to stand in the valleys and get between those two sides that are in conflict. And we've never got into the politics of life, but you know what? At some point, we got to stand for what's right, regardless of who's on what side. You know, we can't win this battle. We can't change this world on our own. We can't reach out to people and get them saved. We can't right this nation on its own. The battle in this nation is God's battle, not ours. But we are the fighters. Can it get better? Certainly. Will it get better? It's up to us. Aaron didn't save everybody. When you read that passage, there are people that died. Because he says he stood between the living and the dead. There were people that didn't make it. There are people that we know are not going to make it. But there are people we know that will, if we're willing to get in between. You know, the scripture says that every believer is endowed with a supernatural gift given by God. It is those gifts that are commissioned to the battle. If you can speak, that's a gift. If you can sing, that's a gift. If you can read, that's a gift. If you can help, that's a gift. If you can cook, that's a gift. If you can care, that's a gift. So, we have to ask ourselves this morning, are we willing to be an Aaron? Are we willing to live by the faith that God has put in our hearts? Are we willing to stand in that gap? Several years ago on New Year's Day, anybody watch the Tournament of Roses parade? There was a beautiful float. Suddenly it sputtered, quit, and it ran out of gas right in the middle of the parade. It was the Standard Oil Company's float. The very one that creates the gas that most of us use ran out of gas. Luke 24:9 says, don't neglect your gifts. You are clothed with power. But so many of our believers today, we run out of gas. Now, my father's doctoral thesis in seminary was a book called Pastor, You're the Leader. And in his book, he wrote this: when the church loses its evangelistic vision, it gives up the core of Christian faith and slowly dissolves into complacency and rigor mortis. Rigor mortis is caused when ATP cannot be produced when the body dies. It starts about 3 hours after death. And it will continue to contract the muscles for about 24 to 48 hours until it disappears. But it only disappears when decay begins to set in. If the church is stuck and stiff, it is decaying. This morning, we've got to challenge ourselves. Do we know where our sensor is? Do we know where our heart is? Are we willing to run into the plague of this world and stand in firm assurance that God will protect us and stop those folks from dying? We won't save everybody, but we will save a bunch when we take that stance that God calls us to be. So this morning, the passage is really simple. Standing between the living and the dead. Do we have Aaron's faith and Moses' direction? As we look at the problems that we face in this country, this next year, we're going to face tremendous problems. You think it's ugly now? Wait till re-election comes. You've not seen anything yet. This country is facing something it has never faced in terms of conflict. But we got to quit standing in this concept of political correctness and stand for what God calls us to be, which is the Aarons and the warriors in this battle. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Lord, as we come before you this morning, it is your decisions and your desires that we try to understand. Lord, we know that there's so much going on that we just sometimes want to bury our head and stay away from it. And we ask, Lord, that you give us the strength and the courage to stand up as you call us to be, as we learn your desires, as we read your word. Thank you this morning for all of us being here. Thank you for those folks that are traveling. Thank you for those folks that are watching. Call on their heart to be your warriors. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand with me.
Circle up for prayer.
Circle up.
I'm not driving that cab.
Oh, it's great.
It's funny.
Did you hear
people sleeping there in a thing?
He did the answer.
It's like my dog is closing his eyes open.
Why did Patty live?
She's tired. She wants her plane.
You want to close this?
Sure.
Lord, thank you for bringing this group together today. Thank you for the message that you sent to us through Jim. I just ask that you be with each of us as we go out into the world and be the people that you want us to be so that our world can see that there's a better way. Lord, I ask that you be with us as we go home. Keep us all safe until we meet again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Could you hear him snore?
You should hear my dog.
He snores like that.
Oh, yeah, you can see that was mine.
That
was
quiet. His quiet snore.
Really?
You can hear mine from the other end of the trail. It's like, just let me break in, fall asleep on my couch, and it's him, and he's got that eye open.
Oh, yeah. His eyes, but he's asleep.
His eyes, yeah, he's
and
asleep.
And that's hot. I didn't see that.
Yeah, that was after that first song, so that's why
he ain't missing anything.
Away. I was trying to
pull
that
one down, pull it,
but
the other one.
That's
bad.
What we did last week. Yeah, I wonder where he was taking it to, but.
No, he,
I guess he, and he turned it upside
yeah.
down.
Mine throws it.
I don't know. If you, oh, sorry. I didn't know if you wanted it upside down or what.
Peter, maybe he does. Maybe he likes it better.
Well, look, he's moving it again.
Is he?
Yeah,
he is. Watch him.
He might
like it. He may not like being inside of a ring.
Why not?
Is that why he's doing flipping it over?
Yeah, you need on him this week.
Maybe it's too warm.
Yeah, you like to say he may not like being inside
of 5 seconds.
Sweetie, did you see she's going to ask him?
I usually give them away. Ask mom. I gotta give them to somebody.
Mom.
He said we know.
Is that a
scratcher?
Yeah. Yeah, she must have got herself a good figure. Now I have to figure out which one it wasn't for me. I just turned over that one.
That long ago tonight, you could ask me if you were. I was biting mine last night. I'll bite that one and said I should do it again. It's a beauty mark.
She
was starting to get like a little bit sleepy. Well, she
kisses
about the top of her head.
Why is
she so grumpy,
huh?
Oh.
I have a little angel.
She does. It's rotten. What? Did you?
Because I
didn't watch
the
first. Oh, yeah.
Just to
pretend.
Yeah.
And I
think we might be pooping.
You know, I was wondering if I made a smell a little bit. What's a good time to... Oh, no. I'm holding you by your poop.
It sounds like she said five.
Please, take them all. Okay.
Give them to that kid up there.
I asked him and he said, his mom said no.
I think she missed having a baby.
Take all your
time. She is the happiest, I think, of 5 months.
Listen, you're not a baby anymore. You're a hard man.
No, you want to take them home with you? Are you sure? We have to get rid of them.
I'll take the donut.
Probably need to talk next week about the women's group, too.
Got someone.
Jen Lynn will take the donut home.
She seems very happy. She just...
Who?
Jen
Lynn. Oh, my gosh. Yesterday, she cracked me up. She fell asleep holding this little, that little steering wheel toy. I call it a steering wheel.
Well, here you go.
So she was in her little chair at the restaurant, fell asleep, holding it. And she woke up, and she, like, opened her eyes up, and looked, and just like, oh, I was chewing on this, and just picked it up straight up. It was so cute. It was so cute.